Our next speaker is Dr. Ken Korek. Ken is the senior PI and the chief of the reproductive and developmental biology branch and chief of the receptor biology section at the National Institutes of Environmental Health Sciences. He received his PhD at the Medical College of Georgia, did his postdoc at Harvard. He's been an editor and a co-editor of numerous journals. He's published 400 papers, 105 book chapters. I would say he's here from the government and he's going to help, except that I believe you're traveling on your own funds so that we're not benefiting from you as a government employee. Ken, thank you. Oh, and the title of his talk is Hormonal Control of Embryo Delivery to the Uterus.
Thank you, Jerry. It's a pleasure to be back in Paris and to attend this meeting and to help with its organization, and to thank Zev and Milton for this invitation. And what I'm going to do this afternoon is actually describe for you about a hormone that we haven't heard much about in the last couple of days, which is estrogen, and estrogen hormone action, which has been my research interest for a number of years, but specifically about a new finding that we've discovered or come upon, which has not received a lot of study if you look in PubMed or in the literature. And that actually involves a action of estrogen and hormonal control in the oviduct or the fallopian tube. And so what I'm going to be describing are experimental studies, because what I'll show you we have to do in order to uncover this action of estrogen, which was totally unexpected, you obviously would not be able to do with your patients. So, but hopefully we'll learn from these experimental studies in order to tell us something about its application to clinical medicine. So I just want to start, this project was led by Joy Winathanon, who was a postdoctoral fellow in the lab, with the aid of Sylvia Hewitt, who's my senior technician. Now, just to remind you that estrogens, as well as progestogens, play an important role in reproduction. And the fact that, as you can see, and many of you are obviously very much aware of this, is 11% of women between the ages of 15 to 44 have impaired fertility. And obviously, this is what many of you in the audience are involved with trying to cope with and to deal with clinically. We have developed mouse models for cellular and molecular mechanism of estrogen signaling and its application to particularly female reproductive physiology, although we did discover many years ago that estrogen and estrogen receptor was important in the male fertility as well. So the role of estrogen and estrogen through the estrogen receptor is shown here, which we learned many years ago when we made the estrogen receptor alpha knockout mouse model, the global knockout. And the global knockout, which is not coming, anyway, it's supposed to be alpha, ERCO. The females were infertile, which was no surprise. They had hemorrhagic cystic ovaries. They had hypoplastic uteri, as you can see here. And they lacked estrogen responsiveness. So from these studies, we learned a good deal about, or learned through the analysis of the phenotypes, a good deal about what we now understand some of estrogen's actions and the role of the receptors in mediating these actions, particularly in reproduction. And in addition, there was an implantation defect, as you see here. The alpha ERCOs could not be treated in any manner exogenously in order to to allow implantation. In addition, the global knockouts had a hormonal, females had a hormonal imbalance because of the loss of negative feedback, which was also an ER alpha mediated effect. And so what we needed to do from the global knockout, which allowed us to understand some aspects, but not all because of the phenotypic problems, was to try to generate tissue-specific knockouts, which would then allow us to understand if it was the role of the receptor in that particular tissue that we had the phenotype, or whether it was globally affected. And we actually have reported examples where it's not actually the effect in a particular tissue, but due to a secondary effect in of estrogen action in another tissue. So I want to also explain in this first part where we've learned a little bit about how estrogen is actually stimulating the endometrium and the uterus in the proliferative phase of the cycle. And what this shows is that in an adult mouse, that estradiol stimulates only the epithelial cells of the lining of the uterus, the glandular and epithelial cells, compared to the fact that the stroma and mesenchyme is not stimulated. And so the question was, is the action actually required for estrogen in that cell that's proliferating? Because we know that in the breast and the mammary gland related to mammary tumorigenesis, that it's the epithelial cell of the mammary gland that is required or is mediating the estrogen stimulation of proliferation. And so we made a uterine epithelial specific knockout mouse model, which I think Franco De Mayo has also used this Cree after we had generated it with the Phlox DR alpha animals, and you see that there is estrogen receptor in the stroma and underlying mesenchyme, but none in the epithelial cells. And so this was what was referred to as a uterine-specific knockout. And so the question was, is if we knocked out the receptor in the epithelial cell that proliferates, will there be actually any proliferation at all? And so, in fact, what we saw was that there was the epithelial-specific knockout, having no estrogen receptor in the epithelial cells, responded as well as the wild-type animal. And so you can see this is the BRDU labeling. So the cells are stimulated and proliferating and indicating that, in fact, this was not that you did not have to have ER alpha to mediate the estrogen action in the epithelial cell that was actually proliferating, but you do need it in the mammary gland. Other studies that were done shows that ER alpha is needed in the mammary gland. So we have a model in which other studies, which I don't have time for, showed that in fact it was using a different Cree model from, again, Franco De Mayo's lab, that it's actually the underlying stromal cell that's mediating a mitogenic effect through a paracrine mechanism that actually stimulates the uterus. And so estrogen acts through the stromal cells to mediate what we believe is an IGF-1 mitogenic signal that is causing the proliferation of the epithelial cell. And so epithelial cell proliferation is mediated through the mitogen of IGF-1, it's through estrogen, but it's not through estrogen in the target cell. The whole point of this study. And so the cell-specific roles of ER during pregnancy then also became a factor, because although you don't need the estrogen receptor in the target cell for the proliferation, you need it for encoding components that are needed for the implantation and the stimulation of the uterus. for implantation. So uterine proliferation is crucial for embryo implantation because these mice that had no had receptor everywhere but in the uterine epithelial cells did not implant, as you saw in a previous slide. So to summarize this one first section is to just mention that estrogen-induced proliferation in the adults is epithelial-specific, as I said. The stroma is, an ER in the stroma is needed to mediate the proliferation by stimulating IGF-1, and that has to be juxtapositioned to the epithelial cell in the underlying stromal cells. While breast growth requires the mammary epithelial cell in the mammary epithelial cell ER alpha to mediate that effect. So the two tissues that are stimulated for growth, the mammary gland and the uterus, actually estrogen uses, or the tissue uses, two different mechanisms. It's using a direct mechanism for the breast on the target cell, the epithelium, but in the uterus, it's using an indirect paracrine mechanism on the epithelium through the stroma. And IGF-1, as I mentioned, is induced in the uterine epithelial proliferation independently. So you can actually treat these animals with the growth factor and get the proliferation, supporting the growth factor action. And then the question is do uterine diseases such as adenocarcinomas, uterine endometrial hyperplasia, fibroids, endometriosis, respond to an ER direct or an ER independent signal? And those are some of the studies that our lab is ongoing. So coming back to the epithelial specific knockout, you see that in fact, these animals are infertile. Part of it is due to implantation, but also in the fact that there were few litters in the epithelial-specific knockout compared to the wild type. There's no embryos present in the epithelial knockout uterus. So the expression of epithelial ER alpha is required for implantation. And so this is just to remind you schematic of the process of ovulation and fertilization going through to implantation, and the epithelial knockout animals are infertile, and the question was is why and how is that occurring? So what are the functions of the estrogen receptor in the oviduct? And this is where I said there's very little that has been shown or known about this. There's steroid hormone-dependent changes in oviduct, cellular morphology and physiology that have been reported. Estrogen induces biosynthesis of secretory macromolecules in the oviduct. That's been reported and known. There's a requirement for estrogen-mediated regulation of ovoductal physiology to support initial vent in pregnancy has never been demonstrated. And the clinical findings of various medical procedures augmenting implantation rates with hydrocephalic patients suggesting that aberrant oviductal functions contribute to female infertility. So this is an area, I know we've heard a lot about implantation and ovulation defects and things like that, which are obviously one, but what I'm trying to at least have you consider is that there's also the potential that there's oviductal problems that are going to be involved in these studies. So we made another experimental system, so we have the epithelial knockouts where you see there's no receptor in the epithelium of the oviduct, and then the stromal knockout in which the epithelium has ER, but the stroma is gone compared to the wild type animals that have expression that's different in the ampulla versus the isthmus of the oviduct. And so the question was, is what happens with the knockout of this epithelium, and is the effect in the implant of the infertility due to a loss of epithelial ER or stromal ER as far as estrogen action? And so fertilization and the embryo development in the mice with cell-specific deletion of ER-alpha, you see that this is the one in the wild type, the 1 to 2 cells step, and you see this quantified in the number of embryos. But in the epithelial knockout, all you see is are the debris and the death of the oocytes and the loss of any two-cell embryos in the animals lacking ER-alpha in the epithelium. Where if you have the stroma, you see that, in fact, the stromal response is comparable to that of the wild type, suggesting that this is an oviduct ER-alpha-specific effect. And so loss of epithelial ER-alpha in the oviduct leads to decreased fertilization and increased embryo death. So can the eggs from the females with epithelial knockout be fertilized in vitro? And that was the question, is the problem with the egg or is it in the oviduct? And so we did, we harvested, not we, Joy harvested eggs from the oviduct from the different knockouts in the epithelial, the ER epithelial knockout, and you see that in fact there's a decrease in the number of embryos in going to the morula stage in animals lacking ER alpha. And so then if you take though the remove the oocytes from the ovary directly.
He started at 5:15.
And do IVF, you see that there's nothing wrong with the eggs, that they can be fertilized perfectly well when they are in the ovary, but when they're coming out of the oviduct, there's a obvious decrease in their functionality. And so the microenvironment in the oviduct of the mice lacking ER-alpha is conducive to fertilization, is not conducive to the fertilization or embryo development phase. And so we wanted to try to identify what might be different in the wild type versus the epithelial embryos, and so we did a microarray, and what you see from this microarray profile is that obviously the wild type and the wild type and the C knockouts all segregate in different regions, and that the C knockouts at the different phases are different than the wild type. And so the hierarchical clustering of these replicates of the two groups, the wild type day one versus the wild type day two, and both of this epithelial knockouts at day one and two are totally different as far as the expression of genes in those particular sample groups. So the dynamic gene expression pattern in the wild type on day one and day two is different, and the group of genes over and under expressed in the wild type did not occur in the epithelial knockouts, again supporting the idea that this was an estrogen ER mediated action or effect. And so altered transcriptional regulation with the loss of that receptor in the epithelial cell may contribute to the infertility. And what we did by the clustering analysis is actually find different groupings of genes that or families of genes that you can see here that fall into these categories that came from the analysis with the microarray. And ones that were particularly of interest and importance were those that showed up involving the protease and protease inhibitors. And you see that, as you can see here, there's a differential expression with a high amount of protease expression and a great deal of suppression of protease inhibitors. And here are some of the kallikreins and some of the other specific proteases that are stimulated, and some of the protease inhibitors that are present in the oviduct secretion and fluid that these analyses show are dramatically suppressed compared to the wild type. And I'll just draw your attention to Fetulin B1, which is a factor that it inhibits ovotacin as far as its action on ZP2. And so we'll test for that to see if that's one of the explanations for this infertility. So could altered protease activity impact fertilization? And so in this set of experiments, we wanted to see if the excess protease leads to the premature cleavage of zona pellucida protein, and in particular ZP2, which was one that had been linked with altered fertility. And so the ZP2 cleavage leads to a block in polyspermy, and the question was is how we were going to test for this. And the eggs were harvested from the oviducts 4 hours after ovulation. So they're in, the eggs are in the oviduct for 4 hours in this environment. And then we did a Western blot, and the question was, is the ZP2 protein changed or altered as far as being in that particular environment? And so when you you see this Western blot of the ZP2, from using Jurian Dean's antibody, you see that in the epithelial knockouts that there's ZP2 cleavage where the wild type does not show that cleavage. And this is quantified here showing conversion of ZP2 cleavage in the two different lines of mice. And so the question is whether in fact it's the protease and the effect on the zona pellucida protein which might be affecting the also the membrane of the blastocyst. And so premature ZP2 cleavage could lead to decreased fertilization, which is one factor. And then the increased protease activity altered the ZP protein. Can it alter the ZP protein of the embryo? And so to test for that, we looked at the effect on thinning of the zona pellucida and how it may contribute to the embryo death of these in the knockout. So we took, one cell embryos from the oviduct. Again, these are exposed to that altered environment. And then we added protease to see if it affected the membrane of the embryos. And so then we would evaluate the thinning of the ZP of the zona pellucida. And so what you see is that there's a a dramatic effect on the the embryos that came from the oviduct of the epithelial knockout. And this is then also showing the same effect quantified, that in fact it's easier to destroy the membrane and cause the blebbing and that from the zona. The zona is exposed coming out of the epithelial knockout compared to the wild type. So this is an analysis of zonal lysis that's occurring and with time. And so these lice much faster because they're already susceptible coming out of that environment of the knockout. So this then would indicate there's the loss of epithelial ER in the oviduct due to an excess of protease, which is resulting in the embryo lysis. And what if we were able to block that protease activity? And so we took wild type embryos and that were one-cell embryo donors, and then we transferred them with and without protease inhibitors back into the environment of either the epithelial knockout or the wild type. So the question was, is will this protease inhibitor actually have any protective effect or rescue this embryo loss that we're seeing in coming out of the environment of the oviduct. And so they were transferred back into the oviducts of these two different lines, and then held there for 3.5 days and then flushed. And so what we should get is morular and blastocysts, and if not, then if it's altered as we were seeing in the epithelial knockout, then we would have underdeveloped embryos. And so when one does this experiment, you see in the wild type with the protease inhibitor, the normal development it's quantified here with or without the protease inhibitor, and the wild type is fine. The epithelial knockout has underdeveloped embryos, as you see, without the protease inhibitor. But then when we've added the protease inhibitor, which is serine cysteine protease inhibitors, which are found in or have been associated with oviductal fluid, you see that in fact this dramatically reduces the loss or the underdevelopment. And so it has or would appear to have an improved embryo survival by being able to block that protease activity. So to close, the study has shown is that ER-alpha in the oviduct epithelium is involved with a balanced protease activity in embryo survival and the normal physiological expression of genes and proteins and factors into the oviduct to have efficient fertilization. In the epithelial knockout, it lacks these signals. Excesses of protease is one thing that we found. There's other factors that are being investigated to see what impact they might have on embryo development. And this results in the zona pellucida being damaged and the embryos die. Now this can be, as I showed you, can be experimentally rescued to some extent or protected by protease inhibitors as one action that may be going on. With the stroma knockouts, because the signals are direct from the epithelial through the ER, they have, as we've shown, just the normal wild-type efficiency and fertilization and embryo development. And so, to summarize, the loss of epithelial ER-alpha in the oviduct results in exposure to wild-type embryos to a in the C knockout or the epithelial knockout oviduct is detrimental to normal development because of the environment. It disrupts fertilization process. It leads to embryonic loss on day two of pregnancy. So there's a block between the one cell to two cell stage. There's altered dynamic gene expression patterns during fertilization and early pregnancy, which I showed you some examples of. And then finally, it reveals an important role for oviductal ER signaling in maintaining the proper microenvironment required for fertilization and embryo development. And so finally, one of the questions, at least from a clinical standpoint, is in hydrocephalopinges, is the abnormal innate immune mediators, the proteases in that, are they part of the cause for this compromised embryo development in tubal pregnancies? And then finally, the group that was involved with conducting these studies, the lead was Joy Winathanone with the help of Sylvia Hewitt, as well as others in our group. Thank you.